President David A. Granger held a briefing session on May 20th, outlining his government's expectations of the public service and the duties of its senior managers. The meeting was conducted at the International Conference Center, which will now be known as the Arthur Chung Convention Center.
I do this because this is the 45th anniversary year of our becoming a republic. And Mr. Chung was the first person of Chinese descent who was president of a non-Asian country. It was historic. And he served for 10 years from 1970 to 1980. And sometimes we tend to forget who our first president was. You know, I don't believe that any American can tell you that he forgot who the first president of the United States was. Everybody knows it's George Washington. But in Guyana, we tend to think that we are made up of maybe two ethnic groups or three ethnic groups. Sometimes we forget. And I would like the first president of this country to be remembered. And he'd be remembered by having his name inscribed in this convention center, which was built, I believe, by people from the country of his ancestors.
Describing the public service as the engine of the executive, the president said it is essential that it be an efficient organization.
The world does not stand still. And we in Guyana cannot allow ourselves to be left behind while the rest of the world progresses. And over the last 6 or 7 months, I've been going around this entire country, and I see some bits of the country which are being left behind. I don't believe that Guyana is two countries, coastland and hinterland, city and bush. I believe we are one country. And when I go to some places, you know, in the south of Rukununi, Sawariwa or Awariwanao, sometimes for days there's no contact, no newspaper, no television, no radio, no cell phone. It's like you're living in another country. And I like to tell a story, which was in the newspaper, of Karawap, which I think is in Region 2, village of Karawap, where the villagers have to climb up a coconut tree to make cell phone contact. It's not funny. This is not a big country, but we're starting to see division taking place. A division in which some people are being left behind and other people are moving forward. I would like a country in which the whole people, the whole country, moves forward into this new millennium. For that to happen, we must not allow some bits of the country to be left behind. And the engine that is going to bring about that equality, the engine that is going to bring about that progress, is the public service. We need, therefore, a public service that is relevant, not irrelevant. A public service that has roots in all of our regions and is accessible to all of our people. A public service that is responsive to the needs of the people, wherever they are. A public service that is resourceful. You know, there's what you call the iron law of limited resources. You never have enough. And we have here the designated Minister of Finance, and he'll tell you there's not enough. We need a public service which is reliable. And I mentioned this, the relevance, the responsiveness, the resourcefulness, and the reliability. Because I believe in having stronger regions. And this afternoon we'll be swearing in a minister who's been given responsibility not merely for local government and regional development. He'll be given responsibility for a redesignated ministry called the Ministry of Communities. I see the community as being a place where people interact, not just live in houses, go to work and come home, but communities that live, that have centers, that have playgrounds, that have events and activities, that has a cultural life.
President Granger opined that strong regional administrations are needed, and these are essential in addition to a strong central government to satisfy the needs of residents regardless of where they may live.
I see good aerodromes. Every region should have a good aerodrome, a good sports stadium or sports center, good banks. We have a whole region like Region 1, Marina Winery region, four times the size of Trinidad and Tobago. And there's no bank at Mabaroom in the center. In fact, if you go to Mabaroom, you find only 5 hours light a day. So not much goes on there. But that region is big, four times the size of Trinidad and Tobago. No bank except the Ruku River, which I'm told has an east bank and a right bank and a left bank. But this is one of the problems that we face. Schools. Maybe many schools are being built. Some of them don't have enough furniture, some of them don't have enough teachers. I went to one particular place at Kotata. Teacher asked me if she can get some cement for the floor, because the floor is from earthen floor. We see the regions as centers of business, so that businessmen can come from overseas straight into those regions, transact business. I go to Rupununi again, and the Tushau wants to invite Brazilians to come to rehabilitate the hydropower scheme. He's thinking about developing his region more than some people in the central government who've allowed that facility to lapse for 15 years or more. And this is what they want to see. Regions which are almost like small states. And that's why in our policy we've insisted that every regional center must become a town. Bartica must be a town. Not because I grew up there. Mabaluma must be a town. Madi must be a town. And I think Dr. Rupanai, who was coming to Madi yesterday or day before yesterday, can tell you about the sort of catastrophic situations which can occur when there is no strong governmental presence which is capable of enforcing law and order, enforcing rules and regulations, even rules and regulations, to protect the lives and livelihood of our working people.
The president recalled the Mills Report, which was compiled some 62 years ago. It described aptly what the public service should endeavor to achieve.
And I quote, "The main purpose of a civil service is to be an organ for the presentation to ministers of the product of organized thought and collective experience. This purpose cannot be achieved unless the civil service is composed of men and women of complete integrity who are able to give advice without fear or favor, partiality or prejudice." What it means is that now that a new set of ministers, political ministers, are going into these ministries, they must be a cadre of public servants. The politicians rely on a cadre of public servants who are capable of presenting to their ministers the product of organized thought and collective experience. We cannot function without the public service. And if the public servants fight to be politicians, there will be catastrophe. There will be administrative catastrophe. The public service must live by different rules. The politicians are the representatives who will go to parliament and speak in the interests of their constituencies. But the public servants mustn't try to be politicians. They must give those politicians the best advice without fear or favor.
A public service staff college will be established, with attendance and successful completion of various courses being a prerequisite for future employment into the public service.
The present training division in the public service ministry will be upgraded and converted into a public service staff college. where people will learn public administration and they will understand how the public service is meant to operate in the Cooperative Republic of Guyana. So people will not enter and people will not be promoted unless they qualify to enter that public service and unless they possess that degree of expert knowledge which we require of our new public service. In this regard, you can then consider advancing people to higher ranks within the public service, within the administrative system, based on their experience and their expertise. It doesn't serve the purpose of good administration for a politician to be elected or selected or appointed as a permanent secretary, and his subordinates or her subordinates know more about how the ministry is run than he or she. It should be the other way around. New entrants should look to the senior public servants for guidance and instruction. But sometimes when we bring political appointees and push them into high office, then the public service is turned upside down. The subordinates know more than the superiors. And that doesn't make sense, because that leads to inefficiency. So we need to reestablish the principles on which a career public service is built. There must be seniority, there must be qualification. Advancement cannot be based on political preference. It therefore means, too, that those persons who are advanced in the public service would be best able to give impartial advice to their political ministers. Those of us who pass through the National Assembly would have been impressed every year when the budget is presented. The political ministers cannot answer questions without the presence of a small platoon of public servants who come in with their files and their ledgers, all of their documents. They are the people who are providing the answers, passing little yellow post-it notes to the ministers. In fact, that's the way it should be. The public servants must have the knowledge. But if the public servants themselves are political appointees, it will be chaos in the National Assembly at budget time, or at any other time.
The issue of an adequate salary scale for public servants was also addressed by the head of state. The previous conflictual relationship that existed between government and the public service caused a drop in the morale of workers. This will be corrected.
I'm not interested in working with a disgruntled public service. We have to solve that problem. And we will solve that problem in a consensual manner. We will go back to the bargaining table and discuss with the public servants union what needs to be done. Not only to pay the public servants better, but to ensure a higher level of efficiency. And we have to raise the morale of the public servants throughout the country. When public servants go to serve out of town, we must look at the conditions under which they live, whether they are policemen in far-flung areas, look at the quarters, how frequently they can visit their families, look at the teacher, the accommodation that is provided for them, the conditions of service. And then we'll start to see whether there are ways and means by which we could enhance or improve the morale of our public servants who have to function in different regions of the country. I don't know the turnover of the personnel in the public service, but I get the impression that in many branches of the public service, some of the more ambitious members try to leave as soon as possible because the pay is so low and they're always on the lookout for more lucrative positions. But worse still, when people's pay is so low, they tend to look out for ways and means of making another dollar, sometimes outside of the monthly pay packet, and this causes problems. And I would like to feel that in the months to come, when we have a reformed and improved public service, people, we regard the public servant as unbribable. I'm concerned about graft, and I'd like to have an unbribable public service, so that no foreigner, no minor, no visitor, no tourist should feel that in order to get something done, he has to put his hand in his pocket and give the public servant a raise. And we must work towards creating the type of public service with a high morale, well-manned, with sufficient equipment, so that their performance would be the best in the Caribbean, the best in the hemisphere. When we speak of Asian tigers, when we speak of Singapore, some of the best paid public services in Hong Kong and Singapore, these so-called tigers. They're not tigers simply because you have rapacious businesses. They're tigers because you have efficient public services, and that is what they want to see in Ghana. And that is why I'm insisting on establishing this public service staff college.
The APNU-AFC Coalition Administration's new hallmark will be integrity, impartiality, and intelligence.
Today, I ask you to put Ghana first, to really think about your role, your duty, your obligation as public servants, and let us give the people of Ghana a high-quality public service and a good life.